the people who come here on Saturday come here regularly, usually. So I thought I can like sometimes give more detailed instructions in the sense of giving a series of talks over several weeks, and because the people are usually similar. So yeah, and I thought I'd talk like in more detail about mindfulness of breathing, the Anapanasati Sutta, middle length discourses number 118. And yeah, mindfulness of breathing was the main meditation object that the Buddha himself was practicing with before his awakening. He says in the Sanghutta Nikaya in one sutta. And yeah, also gives, could say, like the most detailed meditation instructions in terms of yeah, how to develop mindfulness of breathing, and then also based on how one can develop all four foundations of mindfulness based on mindfulness of breathing, and by that develop the seven enlightenment factors, and by that realize true knowledge and deliverance. So it's a longer, more detailed discourse, and one can get various things out of it from its own practice. Yeah, I think I just read the introduction from the sutta itself, and the 16, like the Buddha gives 16 different like instructions about different things that one can pay attention to, or how one can develop the mind based on mindfulness of, based on staying with the breath. And so to just read first this part of the sutta and then say more in detail about the first part of the discourse. Yeah, if you haven't read it, mid-length discourses, Anapanasati Sutta, number 118. Thus have I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Savati, in the Eastern Park, in the palace of Megara's mother, together with many very well-known elder disciples, the Venerable Sariputta, the Venerable Mahamoggallana, the Venerable Mahakassapa, the Venerable Mahakachana, the Venerable Mahakotita, the Venerable Mahakapina, the Venerable Mahachunda, the Venerable Anuruddha, the Venerable Revata, the Venerable Ananda, and other very well-known elder disciples. Now on that occasion, elder bhikkhus had been teaching and instructing new bhikkhus. Some elder bhikkhus had been teaching and instructing 10 bhikkhus. Some elder bhikkhus had been teaching and instructing 20, 30, 40 bhikkhus. And the new bhikkhus, taught and instructed by the elder bhikkhus, had achieved successive stages of high distinction. On that occasion, the opposita day of the 15th, on the full moon night of the Pavarana ceremony, the Blessed One was seated in the open, surrounded by the Sangha of bhikkhus. Then, surveying the silent Sangha of bhikkhus, he addressed them thus. Bhikkhus, I am content with this progress. My mind is content with this progress. Strive even more to attain the yet unattained, to achieve the unachieved, to realize the unrealized. I will stay here at Savati for the Kumudi full moon of the fourth month. So one more month. The bhikkhu of the countryside heard. The Blessed One will wait there at Savati for the Kumudi full moon of the fourth month, and the bhikkhus of the countryside left in due course for Savati to see the Blessed One. And the elder bhikkhus still more intensively taught and instructed new bhikkhus. And the new bhikkhus taught and instructed by the elder bhikkhus achieved successive stages of high distinction. On that occasion, the opposite day of the 15th, the full moon night of the Kumudi full moon of the fourth month, the Blessed One was seated in the open, surrounded by the Sangha of bhikkhus. And then he praises the present Sangha and says that they develop different like meditation subjects, for example, metta or compassion, and and then goes on to say, he says, in the Sangha of bhikkhus, there are bhikkhus who are partly devoted to the development of mindfulness of breathing. Bhikkhus, when mindfulness of breathing is developed and cultivated, it is of great fruit and great benefit. When mindfulness of breathing is developed and cultivated, it fulfills the four foundations of mindfulness. When the four foundations of mindfulness are developed and cultivated, they fulfill the seven enlightenment factors. When the seven enlightenment factors are developed and cultivated, they fulfill true knowledge and deliverance. And how, bhikkhus, is mindfulness of breathing developed and cultivated, so that it is of great fruit and great benefit? Here a bhikkhu, gone to the forest, or to the root of a tree, or to an empty hut, sits down, having folded his legs crosswise, set his body erect, and established mindfulness in front of him. Ever mindful he breathes in, mindful he breathes out. Breathing in long, he understands, I breathe in long. Or breathing out long, he understands, I breathe out long. Breathing in short, he understands, I breathe in short. Or breathing out short, he understands, I breathe out short. He trains thus, I shall breathe in experiencing the whole body. He trains thus, I shall breathe out experiencing the whole body. He trains thus, I shall breathe in tranquilizing the bodily formations. He trains thus, I shall breathe out tranquilizing the bodily formations. So I just read only the first four instructions, because then later it's maybe too much to absorb in one go. There's the first four, like the 16 instructions that the Buddha gives, like 16 sentences in Pali, and the first four are more like connected with mindfulness of the body in the sense, in a more narrow sense, like the bodily aspect of the breath. Maybe briefly first, why is meditating with the breath useful? Well, like why? One thing is, you can't observe a breath of the past or of the future. Like you can only observe a present breath. So like if you're staying with the breath, then you also automatically established in the present, and you have to actually observe what is going on in terms of mind states or emotions. And for that it's useful, because it's always connected, connected with sense of being present. Another thing, it's very portable. It's a portable meditation object. You don't need some special Tara goddess visualization or some mandala or whatever. Have a picture to look at it or something like that, or whatever. I don't know what other meditation techniques people might have, but it's always, as long as we're alive, the breath is always present, and so wherever you go, and in principle there is some sensation of the breath you can pay attention to. The breath is also something which is close to one's awareness, something in a way one can say close to us. And also just the simple sensation of breathing can remind us, if you forget the breath. So it's something close to our own experience in a way. Another thing, it's a automatic process. We don't make, usually don't have to make an effort to breathe. on the other hand, it's also influenced by our intention, or like our, we can in some ways like control it to some extent. And so it's also interesting that we can experiment or play with the breath, in the sense that what type of breathing is, what ways of breathing are more relaxing or more creating more tension, for example. So also in this way can be useful. And it's also a bodily process which is very responsive to emotions. For example, if we have fear or anger, or if we notice, then the breath gets more like tense or agitated. And similar, on the other hand, also the way we breathe also can influence our own emotions and mind states. And for example, if we breathe very peacefully, it's in a way very difficult and to get agitated. Doesn't really fit together somehow. And so one can, in a way, observe how mind and body are connected and how the relation is, and also how we shape our experience with the way we pay attention or how we develop the mind. One can observe all these things by mindfulness of breathing. You can also say mindfulness of the body gives a sense of center or like inner stability. The Buddha gives a nice simile, imagine there would be six animals with different domains and different feeding grounds, like a snake, a crocodile, a bird, a dog, a jackal, and a monkey. And then someone would tie them, each one with a leash, and then they would tie the leashes together. And then the snake would pull one way, the crocodile would want to get into the water, the bird would want to fly into the air, and the dog would want to go into the village, the jackal would want to go into the jungle ground, and the monkey would want to go into the forest. So they would pull and put all in different directions. And when they get tired, then the most powerful animal would win and the others would just get pulled along. And basically then depending on our own, they may be more attracted towards pleasant things to see or to hear or to taste, then we get pulled in this direction. And so we get basically pulled here and there by our own desires or mind states. And then on the other hand, the Buddha says, if you imagine there would be the six animals with leashes, and then someone would tie them to a post or to a pillar, and then they would be tied onto this pillar, and then for some time they would still try to get away or run around, but then they would calm down close to that pillar or sit down there. And in a similar way, he compares the mindfulness of the body with a pillar or a post. So in a sense, the activity of the mind can come to rest, thereby develop mindfulness of the body. One also sees in the instruction that the Buddha gives, he says that the mindfulness of breathing can lead all the way to develop the seven enlightenment factors and to develop and realize true knowledge and liberation. So one can develop calm, samadhi by the breath, but also develop insight with the breath. And already with this text, just with this very brief summary in a way, just 16 different qualities that the Buddha describes. One can already notice that one can see more than just in and out with the breath. I don't remember who it was, but some, I think maybe Ajahn Lee was asked once by some senior monk how one can develop insight by observing the breath, because it's just in and out, it always seems to be, we can say it's always the same. But then, yeah, there are more details to see actually. Like then, like Ajahn Lee said, like, if that's all you see, then that's all there is. So like there is more to actually see or notice if you pay careful attention. Yes. If that's all you see, then that's all there is. So like if you don't see more, then that's what you see, but there is actually more to see in a way. Like yeah. Would be like just in principle. So yeah. Yes. Mm. It depends, I would say. For example, if you, one thing with regard to seeing anicca or like anicca anupassi, like contemplating or seeing impermanence, one breathes in and out, or then contemplating or seeing fading away or cessation. One can also explain, like one aspect of this process is by staying with the breath, the usual desire and mental dejection and unwholesome states usually involved in they pass away, so and fade away. And I think this is something one can see also on a, like in some extent, for example, if you stay with the breath, you can maybe notice to some extent that usual preoccupation with the world of the mind fades away to some extent. And this is one aspect of maybe seeing impermanence or like anicca. But the other, like basically by staying with the breath and by developing samadhi, one can experience like the gradual cessation of sankharas. And so by staying with the breath, first more coarse sankharas like sense desire, aversion and restlessness and so on fade away. One can notice this to some extent maybe, and then like the mind becomes more peaceful and samadhi stronger, and then like more and more the qualities, mental qualities to more and more refined level, like fading away, and the mind becomes more and more peaceful. And so in this way, it's also something that the Buddha describes in this in the stock description of jhana. He uses this word that actually in a way connected with what the Buddha describes in the Anapanasati Sutta. For example, in the second jhana, for example, like vitakka vicharanam vupasama, like vupasamo, like the stilling of thought and directed thought and evaluation. And then in the third jhana, pitya chaviraga, like the fading away of rapture. But then the fourth jhana, the atangamo, like the passing away of like joy and dejection. So like this is in a way also connected with this last tetrad. At least this is my understanding, that if one stays with the breath then and develop samadhi, one can experience the gradual cessation of sankharas in this way. So like first, say in first there is still like samadhi connected with thoughts, connected with the breath, and then this fade away, and then the mind gets more and more subtle. And I think that's like on the one hand the one can know then experience for oneself that the stilling of formations is peaceful, and on the other hand, one can experience cessation, like by something the usual, by the fading away of the usual preoccupation or the usual desires and aversions. One experienced like the cessation of desire, aversion, and illusion in a way, to some, at least in a relative sense, and then one can, so in this direction, like for example, also like experiencing cessation. It would be like, I think in a way that's a more useful like way of seeing impermanence than thinking, okay, this thing is impermanent and this sitting class is impermanent and so on. It's also one way of, I think it's also, for example, I also practice like, for example, like contemplating the decay of the body and so on. It's also like, if the contemplation of external things and the own body leads to the mind being more peaceful or experiencing dispassion and inner peace, then that's useful. But then actually, I would say the more important aspect of cessation is actually then the seeing that desire, aversion, and delusion can come to cessation. Rather than, okay, this matter is impermanent, it's just, yeah, like, I think that's, yeah, if I'm, in a way I would see it more like that, yeah. But that's then for the last tetrate, so that's a preview for later. Also in sense also what I said about the like just the breath just being in and out, one can say like the breath is almost like even like putty, like these things that the kids play with putty, and then you can make different like scary shapes out of it or beautiful shapes. And similarly with the breath, you can like the breathing can be like tense or oppressive or rough and unpleasant. Or it can be like calm and smooth and peaceful, and like a sublime and ambrosial dwelling, like the Buddha says. So one can, yeah, there is, the breath is almost like some shape, and then it can have different qualities. Yeah. The first four instructions of the Buddha, the first two are like breathing in long, he knows a breathe in long and breathing out short. Like breathing, like noticing that the breath is short and long, and like pajanati, like knowing or not knowing whether the breath is short or long, and so like attuning to the quality of the breath and noticing whether it's short and long and staying there with the whole in-breath and out-breath. And as I said, we can also notice different qualities, like for example the breath can be more like rough or very smooth, or like regular, irregular. For example, if someone has some problems with the lung or with the breathing, then the breathing can be very irregular. And well, otherwise it can be like very like a nice rhythm. And so one can notice different qualities in the breath, but the Buddha talks about like long and short. And this is only it's also the only one of these instructions where the Buddha says he knows like pajanati, then the other like in the rest of the 16 steps of mindfulness of breathing, the Buddha then always uses the word sikkhati. He trains himself to basically pay attention to the breath in a certain way or to develop a certain quality based on the breath. the first two, like long and short, and then the next one is in Pali Sabakaya Patisangvidi Asasisamiti Sikati. Like he trains himself, I will breathe in experiencing the whole body, I will breathe out experiencing the whole body. There are different interpretations, maybe just also to mention, like maybe two, I and some other monks, they understand it literally in the sense one actually is aware of the whole body and breathing in and out. But the conventional interpretation is that you are like that this Parivartkaya would mean the whole body of the breath, in the sense like you're all the time continuously aware of the breath. This is the body of the would be the body of the breath. But yeah, that's basically the reason for giving this interpretation is then the way meditation and also like jhana, meditative absorption, is explained in the Visuddhimagga, because they want to focus you. They don't want you to focus on one point. They don't want you to focus on the whole body, but they want you to focus on one point and then absorb into this point, and then if you can stay with that, like some lights, nimitta image would appear, and then you leave the breath and stay with this light, which is the, at least I can't really find it this way in the discourse of the Buddha himself. So I see it more in this way, that one actually is aware of the whole body breathing in and out, and there are also indications for that this is actually the meaning. For example, in how the Buddha describes jhana, he says the monk actually rather pervades the whole body with rapture or with the happiness. So there's also like mentioned, like actually it seems to be some whole body awareness, which is different from the normal experience that we have, but it's still some form of whole body awareness and experiencing the whole body to be pervaded by rapture or happiness. So this is for me like an indication that it actually means the whole body, basically, not the... that's my interpretation, and also for some other monks, but just to mention it, for example, like, say, Paok would be a classic Visuddhimagga type meditation instructions, where you develop it in this other way, where you... the idea you focus on some point, and then you get some light image and focus on this light image. Another thing that some senior monk said sometimes, for example, that people who are very good in this type of developing samadhi, of observing, staying with one point and absorbing in that, they're usually very good at denial. Like, if you're very good at staying with one point, then usually you need to block out all of your experience, basically, to just stay with this point, and everything else you blank it out and block it out. And so his observation that he made was people are usually good at denial. This is the skill that is required to get this type of samadhi. But yes. I think then I would say like more like in the sense of that the Buddha not use like renunciation in a sense of, yeah, I think I see it more like giving up a smaller happiness for larger or like a more stable happiness, while denial I would see more like ignoring some experience, like not wanting to notice it. Like, let's say someone, that's a good example here, like you have a certain habit and actually it's a bad habit, and then but you just don't want to see that, basically, either consciously or unconsciously, and you deny it. And that's what I would see as denial, at least that's what my the difference between the two the qualities, like renunciation or transcending sensuality, and then denial. For example, denial, let's say someone has strong sense desire, and then it just hit us, doesn't want to look at it and just pretends it's not there. And that would be denial, while renunciation would be then to actually like remove the thoughts from the mind, actually see, okay, the mind is actually obstructed by sensuality. How can I remove the thoughts? And how can I develop another form of happiness? That would be more like the renunciation, but this denial is then, yeah, that would be like another example of the difference. Another thing that also the Buddha describes in Samadhi, that's the onlooking or observing quality of the mind gets stronger, like with mindfulness and equanimity. So it's very different like from like observing, like onlooking, but then absorbing or like being absorbed in one point. It's also like a different, like it's also a difference that I see. But it's just a footnote if you ever come across about what people think about what it means, the whole body, then yeah, there are these different ideas about it. And if you so yeah, like as I said, like I take it as like actually being aware of the whole body, breathing in and out. And yeah, you notice obviously it takes some effort or training to be aware of the whole body. It's not like something that just happens by itself, but you have to make some direct your attention and just anchor your awareness with the whole body. And that's exactly what the Buddha describes with this paripatic sikkhati. He trains himself. Also, you probably noticed we are maybe aware of some parts of our body, but some not so much, or in certain activities, maybe, or whatever, thinking, not at all. So it can also be like one of these old maps where there are like white blank spaces where there's unknown territory, in the sense that we have some partial awareness of the body, and then large areas we actually don't know that we are tense there, or what is, like usually I don't feel much, let's say up here, but I don't feel that much sensation there because it's a neutral sensation. Or maybe if you're talking with someone, you're not aware how your toes are feeling or something like that. yeah. So in meditation, yeah, you can build up whole body awareness by directing attention to different areas of the body and seeing, can you feel some breath, some sensations of the breath there, like for example the head, what type of breathing sensations can you feel? The area of the head or in the chest or like the arms, can you feel some movement in the arms? And for example, you can like in the beginning of the meditation session just like feel different areas of the body and then expand your awareness and feel the whole body to actually, because we're not aware that we are blanking out certain areas of the body usually. Often we don't notice. Is the body really completely, disappearing? But it's not so clear anymore. I would more, like if you can't feel your body so clear or the breath so clear, I would actually breathe in a way, if you can still be aware, you can also like, for example, let's say if the breath is very, very soft and subtle, and you can stay with it, even though it's very soft and very subtle, then you can just stay with it in this way. But if it's difficult to stay with it, then I would just make it actually deliberately change the way you're breathing and make it more clear, rather than just some for example, if it can be very difficult if the mindfulness is not so strong to stay with a very subtle sensation. And also it doesn't seem very interesting then in a way. It's just like you have this subtle, almost unnoticeable sensation. And it can be very difficult, like there seems to be not much like in the sense of interesting then there to be there. But if you can breathe in a way which is sort of clearly noticeable and peaceful, you know, the mind can attune to that and become similar. This there, like, that's would be my idea. Like, and also, if, for example, if the experience of this is my experience, it more like, for example, if you, let's say, you develop awareness of the whole body. Like I don't feel that much, like then let's say I'm meditating and I don't feel that much, okay, that my toe feels like that and my ear feels like that, but it's more like a ball, more like that, like some ball, and then there's the sensation of expanding and contracting of the breath. It's not so much, okay, like here's my nose and here's my eye and whatever, like it's more like that. Yeah. I think it's more like also like in the sense of developing samadhi. I think this usual perception of the body that we have in samadhi, in the sense of okay, there's my little finger and so on. Basically, I can say like it fades away. The perception of the body becomes different, and it's more like a ball or some sphere of attention and some sensations, and then there's this expanding and contracting sensation, which is peaceful and pervading the body. So then similar, like the Buddha gives this, actually this similes for the jhanas, for example, this, in the first jhana, like the, I'm a bathman, like has some soap powder and then he sprinkles it with water, puts some water on it. People don't know that anymore. It was a simile that was useful there, but you have this soap powder and then you sprinkle it with water and you knead this powder and the soap ball becomes pervaded completely with the water and without dripping, it becomes completely like pervaded and infused with this water, and so too like the body becomes pervaded by the rapture, the happiness based on samadhi, the whole body, and so it's more like the whole body, and then this sensation of the breath pervading the body, or the experience of the body, and yeah, so it's a different experience of the body than we usually have, in the sense that this usual, yeah, way of perceiving the body becomes different. I think that's normal. Yeah. I think it's actually, yeah, it is actually true. For example, if you close your eyes, actually it's not so sure, is the body actually the, you can't really, even if you touch it, I feel the border now, but if you actually don't touch it, it's not so clear where is actually the real border of the body. Like you just feel this expanding and contracting sensation of the breath, which just expands in space, basically. And there is no clear like border of the breath expanding and contracting. And I think that's actually a good, in a way, it is a pleasant like a perception of the breath, So I think it's good to develop and stay with this perception. I think no need to basically create the perception of a border, because it just creates a feeling of narrowness. And one can even like experiment, like what does it do if you have a limited perception of the breath? Like you have a certain, like you, let's say if you're, basically you have a sphere of attention, like a ball, like this, and it's a limited sphere, and you stay with this limited sphere and the sensation of the breath. Or you just, actually there is no, you just have this perception of the breath, which just expands and contracts without any basically limit or a clear boundary, and see what effect it has on the mind, or what is more peaceful for the mind. And the other one also I wouldn't worry too much about, in the sense of attaching to peacefulness of samadhi. I think then maybe when one is non-returner, then one can worry about having too much attachment of samadhi. I think in the sense, if it's, for example, if you, let's say you want to meditate and you get angry if someone disturbs you or something like that, I think that's unbeneficial. But I think otherwise, like samadhi is something to be developed, actually. Like, so from that perspective, I think if you actually develop this perception of the breath and there's a pleasant sensation and the body gets pervaded by it, that's actually, then it's good to stay with this perception and to actually develop this perception, so that this happiness or gets even more pervasive. It's actually then a skill, basically, that's like the Buddha describes in the first jhana, for example, that one pervades the whole body with that. But also like not necessarily every form of inner happiness that arises from samadhi is jhana, but also like before the Buddha describes, like one can experience like pamoja, like inner joy or rapture or tranquility or happiness, and then when they become like more strong, then the mind more unified, then yeah, so it's very useful to have this perception of the breath, I think, and stay with that and develop that. It's also good to stay with the whole body. It's also a good way of staying present, because usually if we distracted or go more in the past or future, usually our awareness is somewhat shrinking, or like it's very difficult to be aware of the whole body and then like mentally proliferate, or yeah, somehow it's it seems to be like the mindfulness or like the awareness of shrinks, like if you're involved in this distraction. And then the last one, Pasambayang Kaya Sankarang Asasisamiti Sikati. I breathe in and out, tranquilizing the bodily formations. In some other discourses, the Buddha actually defines bodily formations as in and out breath. So I think in one sense one can say like the breath can become more, the feeling or experience of the breath can become more calm and peaceful by staying with it, by developing mindfulness of the breath. Also, yeah, how we sense our body through our in and out breath, and also the way our breathing experiences our, like the way our breathing influences our experience of the body. Depending on how we breathe, we have a different feeling of our body, of how it is. Yeah, basically we from the time of our birth or yeah, whenever we picked up certain, or we have certain, developed certain ways of relating or perceiving the breath, and some are associated with more tension or unpleasant way of feeling our body, and some are more peaceful. And so one can observe that, and also, for example, like yeah, sometimes we can also like exaggerate the breathing in a way we're actually breathing too much. Actually, it wouldn't. We just have this idea of how our breath should be, and actually we wouldn't have to breathe so much, and can be in the sense of pulling in and out, pulling the breath in and out. And actually, yeah, there's this strong the perception of having to pull it in and out. But actually, just we wouldn't have to make so much effort, but just to see how it's. We can also, for example, like just if you sit there, just see if there's, just observe, is there another in breath coming? And then see that sometime the body will breathe in. If you're not dying yet, then we'll breathe in again. And just see. Yeah, on the other hand, as I already said, this can also be, then if the breath is too subtle, then we can't observe it, so it can also be useful sometimes to actually control it. I already talked about it in a way, like the perception or the mental image that we have of our breath. Like has an impact on our experience or determines our own experience, also like, yeah, like determines our own experience of the body and of the breath. For example, I think often one has this perception that we pull the breath in through the mouth or through the nose. But actually, like if the feeling that actually in a way one has the perception that I pull the breath in through the nose. But actually the nose is just, the mouth is just like just holes in the body. They don't pull any air in. Actually the thing is actually the diaphragm and the muscles between the ribs actually making the effort of pulling the breath in. And so we have this whatever cartoon idea of how we pull the breath in. But actually that's a completely different part of the body that actually does the breathing. And actually the muscles between the ribs and the diaphragm are basically creating this movement there and actually doing the effort of pulling it in. I had a look, we have this little body whirls like catalog, and then I had a look because I didn't want to say something wrong. I don't know much about it. I'm not anatomy, but I had a look, and actually it's the diaphragm and these muscles between the ribs. There's no muscle in the nose that pulls the air in or the mouth. It's just like, yeah, it's like it's just a hole in the body. Yeah, the Buddha doesn't give a special place where to observe the breath. I think it's just most useful to just see where you can feel the breath most easily and stay with that area. And then, if you like, sometimes you can feel different areas of the body and then develop this more like whole body awareness and the breath flowing in and out. So there's no like some meditation technique systems have very specific areas where you should focus, and this is the area where you have to focus and for our system and whatever. Yeah, but it's yeah, like at least my, I think it's not so important at least. general, like the order of the progression of the 16 steps that the Buddha is teaching, I think there is some progression in a way, but also one can develop different qualities that I mentioned later. For example, say later the Buddha talks, I will breathe in gladdening the mind or breathe out gladdening the mind. And I think one doesn't have to wait until one develops everything before, but actually one can also, if someone has some unwholesome mind state, breathing in gladdening the mind, in a sense just, yeah, I think this is also an option to just go to a certain quality that is helpful, rather than just doing everyone after one after another, I think. Yeah. And in terms of like parikrama meditation, in the sense of using a word to direct the mind to the breath, some people like counting the breath from 1 to 10 or something and back and forwards. I've never found this. It's just very, you know, like a accountant or what. I don't know. I wasn't so enthusiastic about it. But then, yeah, you can use, like using the word Buddha, the classic way is, for example, with the in to label. Basically, the idea of this is that you use a thought to direct actually the mind to the breath, because then it makes it clear is the mind staying with the breath, and yeah, that's basically like a tool you can use to direct the mind to the breath. And with Buddha, the classic one is to, with in-breath, Buddha, and with out-breath, Dho. But you can also like do it in a different rhythm, either in the rhythm of the breath, or also disjoin the recitation of Buddha with the breathing, and just recite Buddha in some rhythm, and pay attention to the breath. You can also like use other sentences. For example, like I sometimes used like the sentences from the actually from the Anapanasati Sutta, like Savakaya Patisangvidi, and feeling direct like experience in the whole body, or like, for example, you can just repeat the word like whole body or calm together with the breathing in some rhythm, if it helps to direct the mind to a certain quality of the breath. For example, if you think whole body, it helps to direct the mind, actually directing it to this quality of being aware of the whole body and noticing, are you actually staying with it? Walking, where you can also, at least I also can also do like feel the breath while walking. Some area here. Also possible. Also this change that we described from how we experience our body. I think that's also what the Buddha describes in the four, like Satipatthana, with the usual like the refrain like Kaya Kaya no passi viharati atapi sampajano satima vinaya loke abhichato manasang. So like one dwells with regard to the body, contemplating the body, having abandoned desire and mental dejection with regards to the world. So I think our usual way of how we relate to the body, whether our body is beautiful or ugly, or tall or short, or old or young, these are all these perceptions and ideas, memories that we have about our body. And by staying with the breath, this they fade away in a way. This way of relating to the body fades away, and one dwells, having abandoned. That is usual way of how we identify with the body or how we see our body. And yeah, when we just pay attention with to the breath and the whole body, and then we don't think about it anymore, like whether we look beautiful or ugly, or whether we're old or young or something like that. It's just more like coarse ideas about ourselves, but yeah, like similar with that. And then we experience the body just as like warmth or pressure or sensations. We have some experience of these things, more like this. So it's a little bit different experience. If you want to read more, you can read the Anapanasati Sutta that I already mentioned. Or then there's also in the Sanghutta Nikaya, in the connected discourses, Sanghutta number 54 is about mindfulness of breathing. There are shorter discourses about mindfulness of breathing there as well. Yeah, then strive even more to achieve that unachieved, to attain that unattained, to realize that unrealized. And I see you next week for the next four Anapanasati instructions.